Hi everybody, welcome to the Spring 2016 York TCA Museum presentations. I'm Jack Lynch, I'm with Bachmann Trains in Philadelphia, an hour or so down the road, 2 hours, it was 3 hours this morning with traffic. Beautiful day out there. From what I saw in the news, you've got 4 days of beautiful weather. It's glorious. Get outside and walk around a little bit, you know, in addition to going into all the halls or walk between them. I'm kind of happy today because I got to bring a lot of my favorite things. That's kind of selfish, I know, but it just kind of worked out that way, that I've got a lot of Pennsylvania Railroad. I've got a nice special large-scale thing here that I'm really excited about to show you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over my different pieces here, and I got a couple things here, and then I'll wrap it up with this really special project that I worked on that is coming very soon that's really neat and exciting. Okay, so every year when I do this, I usually try to bring an example of how we translate scales up and down, and I got lucky this year because I got to bring my favorite locomotive, which is the GG1. You know, I'm sure if I asked for a show of hands, there wouldn't be many hands that wouldn't go up if I asked if you know this locomotive or have seen it. It's iconic. It's like the Dreyfus Hudson and, you know, the various other Santa Fe F units and so forth. What we're doing is I brought this one along because in the Williams line, we've been asked, you know, numerous times to bring the scale GG1 back. So what we're doing is we're bringing it back. We're bringing it back with True Blast Plus sound, with our new sound system, the digital sound system that's recorded from real locomotives. Our OEM company Soundtracks in Durango, Colorado does all the board work for us. So the boards are made here in the States, the sounds are recorded here, and so forth. And it really is a nice sounding loco. If you've ever heard our HO scale, GG1, it's the same sound set in the bigger piece. We're doing this one, this is the Tuscan piece. We're doing it in Tuscan, we're doing it in green, Brunswick green. We're doing the green freight scheme with the single stripe, which you see down here in the front, and the congressional silver scheme. I believe there are three of those. So that's coming. I believe these are in the warehouse, actually. The GG1s are here now, so, you know, come over and double check it with Larry at the booth, but I'm pretty sure the dealers have these at this point. I brought the HO scale GG1 that released it about 2 years ago. Very proud of this piece. This piece was researched at great length. We went around the corner to the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania, lucky to have it in our backyard and lucky to have a good relationship with the folks at the museum. They let me come in early a couple days and crawl all over it. I couldn't go in it. You know, they shut them up now because of PCBs and things like that, so you can't go inside. But we got to go underneath and take pictures of the bell and so forth and the running gear. And luckily, it's right underneath of the catwalk in the museum, so we got a lot of nice photographs of the top. And then the research archivist went, his name, I believe, is Nick, pulled a lot of the original erection drawings and so forth for us. So this GG1 in HO is really, really accurate. It is a really nice piece. And as I said, I like to show the transition in scales. The new piece that we just announced at the last NMRA convention is an N-scale GG1. The N-scale GG1 is right dead on the HO piece. It's a very nice scale piece with lots of detail. So the N-scale GG1 also incorporates our new sound value DCC boards, which is a board that we do with Soundtracks in Durango, Colorado. It's made here in the States. It incorporates 16-bit digital polyphonic sound, which polyphonic means the bell and the whistle can be played at the same time. Has a lot of extra features. We do sound value boards because it brings the price down a little bit. We incorporate the sound chip directly into the printed circuit board, so it saves us a little bit on assembly and makes it more economical. And with sound value, what we've done is we've cut the sound features back to where it's all the features you want, less some of the more esoteric sounds like Fireman Fred shoveling coal and a coupler clank. We named this project, when we were doing sound value boards, we named it, you know, unofficially, Woo Woo Chuff Chuff Ding Ding, which means it's got the prime mover, the bell, the whistle, and, you know, whatever else, just the prime sounds that you need to run the locomotive, which most guys use. You know, there aren't many guys out there pushing Fireman Fred all day long and things like that. So that's my scale up and down piece for this time. And like I said, it's my favorite loco, GG1s. We also did an N-scale to go with the GG1, a new set of N-scale passenger cars. These are corrugated, streamlined, 85-foot cars. This is the baggage. Well, the baggage is less than 85, but there's your observation car. Coach didn't come in by the time I left the shop, but you're welcome to come up and look at these. These are beautiful cars. We're doing four different schemes to start with, which would be the Pennsylvania scheme, obviously, to go with the GG1s. We're doing Baltimore and Ohio. We're doing Santa Fe, and we're doing an unpainted silver set so that if someone has an obscure road name that they want to put on it, you can do that. Buy some decals and make up your own set. So these are really, really nice cars. They're LED lighting, very nice constant lighting. I ran them all day yesterday on the test layout, and they didn't flicker once. So come up and take a look at those. In Williams, we have released our NW2s are in stock. I brought a couple of them just to let you guys know that they are now in stock. They're at the dealers. I brought two of the four. I brought my favorite. I brought Pennsylvania. I have a real thing for Pennsylvania. My grandfather was an engineer on the railroad, so anything Pennsylvania gets me happy. I brought the Western Pacific just to, so that you can see a contrast in paint schemes. These also feature the new soundboard, the new digital soundboard, the True Blast Plus boards. So these have your nice prime mover sound that notches up and down. It has a digital horn, a digital bell, great lighting. They're just really nice pieces, nice upgraded pieces. So there's Pennsylvania, Western Pacific. There's a Union Pacific one that's black. Most people say Union Pacific switchers are armor yellow and gray or armor yellow. We found photographic evidence, a couple, three or four photos of one that was painted black with yellow lettering. And it's really sharp and it's really different. So if you already have an NW2 or you have switchers and you're into UP, that's one that you may not have because it's pretty darn unique. So we're doing Pennsylvania, Western Pacific, we're doing the Union Pacific and a B&M in blue. So those will be over at the hall. You can come look at them. The dealers should have them. Gentleman down here earlier was asking me about Easy Street, our traction type track. In other words, it's track that you run vehicles on or traction power, trolleys and PCC cars, things like that. We just got in, probably within the last few weeks, all of our trucks. I know I showed the prototypes last time, but these are all official production pieces. So we released a pickup truck. Pickup truck comes with, well, that's hard to say, pickup truck. It comes with different loads in the back. This one is a luncheon truck. You know, it's got the silver sides, corrugated sides. I think it's Hot Joe and Dough. So it's your pickup truck. This one's an ice cream truck. It's like your Good Humor truck, that type of truck. We did one with a load with crates and barrels and things in it in two different colors here, green and a tan. And a nice red and white pickup truck with a crane in the back or a tow cable. And a new piece that we're announcing right now, it's a repaint of one of our sedans, but we did it in a fire chief scheme, which is very nice. It's a red and a white with a light on top. This will be here very soon. So that's what I have for now. We have a lot of other Williams products in the line that we're working on, but they weren't quite ready for us to release the information yet. The next thing I'd like to talk about a little bit is something that I've introduced. I've talked about it at length. It's a product that, like I say, I brought my favorite things, and I think this is my favorite product that we've worked on in years. And I know it's not O-scale yet, and that's our EasyApp product, our EasyApp control system. EasyApp is basically a Bluetooth chip mounted in a locomotive so that you can use your smart device to run the train. In other words, I know there's digital command out there now, and you've got mics, PS2 or DCS, I should say. You got Lionel with TMCC and so forth. Nice systems, and I know that they're touting that they've got control systems that you can use your smart device with and so forth. But what makes this device or this system, and I hesitate to say system, but what makes this product really unique is the fact that you need no other peripherals to do this other than buying, and I'm going to step down here for a sec, other than buying a locomotive. In other words, if I go out and I want to buy, one of the other manufacturers' smart device software, I have to already have their command system, which is usually a track interface unit, command station, so forth. Then you have to have a router to pick up a Wi-Fi signal because they do theirs with Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is what you use for your laptop or for your smart device at home. It's the router that's there that Verizon or whoever Comcast brings in and mounts into your wall. So to use the other systems, you need the router, you need the new interface unit that they sell so you can do this, then you need the original control system, then you usually have to download more software to reconfigure the track interface unit you have, blah, 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 blah. So we're talking about a lot of configuration to get yourself to a point where you can take your phone and run your train. With the Bluetooth system, with Easy App, basically, if you want to try this, and I know most of you guys are O-gauge. I'm not going to ask the question, have you raised your hands again? Everybody knows I like to do that, but it's HO right now, and all I can say is we'd be really foolish not to move it around into the other scales. You know, and we're always working on new things, as you see up and down. Right now, it's HO, and the reason we did HO is because HO is the lion's share of what we sell. Believe it or not, there are more HO modelers than anything else out there, and they're very adamant. They're very hardcore, and what we've done is we picked the scale where we can get this out and get it going, you know, full throttle before we move into the segments that are a little smaller, which would include HO, or I should say O-gauge, large scale. N-scale we can't do yet because the Bluetooth module is just a little too big, but they're working on a smaller one, so that's coming too. But I digress. It's the simplicity that makes this beautiful. You have a Bluetooth chip mounted into the circuit board in the engine. Now, guy comes in and says, I have an iPhone. I'd really like to try to run it. What do I need to buy? That's it. That's all you need to buy as a locomotive. You put it on, you go to the iTunes store or you go to the Google Play store. Our Android version will be released. It's scheduled to release June 1st. So that'll be here too. So Android, Apple will be here by June. We already have iOS. That's out there. It's being bought. It's being played with. You download the app into your phone. It's just like any app you download, your map app, your, you know, Facebook, whatever. Just download the app. Put the train on the track. Put full power onto the track. Start the app up. Bang. It finds the engine. You start running. Multiple locomotives, various other things. All the settings are on a nice setting screen that is really easy to manipulate or use. It's very user-friendly, very intuitive. It goes from where DCC is a 1980s protocol that is hardware-based. Easy App is a software-based system. So in other words, if we incorporate new features into Easy App, you don't have to buy anything new. Basically, when you start that app, it's going to say there's a firmware or there's a software update available, just like on your phones when you have an app. You'll say, okay, upgrade. Bang. Upgrades the app and you've got the new features, and it'll do it for the firmware, which is the Bluetooth chip inside. So the older systems are usually hardware-based, which means when you buy it, it is what it is. It does not change. So if they change it and do new features, sometimes they'll do a software patch where you got to go through a lot of rigmarole to upload it from your PC and plug it all together and blah, blah, blah. Not this. This is, like I say, the simplicity is the real beauty of this thing. I can't express that or you know, say enough about that. It's, if you want to try this, just buy a locomotive. That's it. Nothing else. As long as you got a smart device that's Bluetooth 4, you're there. So that's enough about Easy App. Come and try this at my booth. I have a layout set up. I've got an iPad sitting there mounted on a thing. Come over, I'll let you play with it all day long as there's no kids around, because once a kid gets on it, you're not touching it. I give it to kids and they're there for an hour and a half and you have to pry it out of their hands. So that's another thing to think about. If you got kids and you want to get them away from the video games, you know, they can still play with their iPad, but get them hooked up to the real world with that virtual world, and that's where we're kind of going with this. I mean, there are a lot of potential applications that we're exploring and we're working on with the guys that have done this. Right now it's a cab to run your trains, but we see it as going more toward the gaming end of it. In other words, incorporating virtual, or I should say automated running of your trains, plus things where, you know, go to the water tower, fill up your sight glass. As it gets lower, you got to go back and fill it up again. Automated running, you know, things of that nature. So keep that in mind. Come see me. Come play with this. Try it. Don't scoff it and say it's dumb until you come and try it, because it's simple. I'll get you at the end. I'm going to take questions at the very end. All right. So that was that. I got one more thing I want to talk about before I bring this big thing up. We have some new scenery products, and I believe these are in the warehouse. And if they're not, they'll be here extremely soon. We have a line of scenery products and buildings called Scenescapes. And Scenescapes encompass trees, grass mats, things of that nature. Well, we've hooked up with some manufacturing, and we're going to bring in a little bit more, a little more refined product. In other words, we're going to do things like little grass tufts. And if you go over to Scenic Express in the hall, Jim, he carries a lot of this type of product. Scenery products, I can't say enough about how cool they are. I'm a diorama guy. I like building models. I like sculpting, things like that. So these things really, I get excited about them, even though it's a piece of grass. You know, it's not exactly exciting, but I like them. But what we're doing is we're trying to refine the line with things like static grass. Static grass is a pull-apart grass. I don't know if any of you have ever seen Nock products from Germany or any of the other companies that make this. What it is it's grass that comes in a tuft, and you pull it apart. You put your white glue down. You sprinkle it on there, and then you use either a static applicator or you find something you can create static with, a balloon, rubber balloon, get static on. And as you draw it across this grass, the grass stands up, and it actually looks like growing grass straight up. I would encourage you to go to our website, look at the videos and so forth, but we have little tufted grass mats. These things are really neat for applications other than just model railroading. I build models and paint things and do scenery and things of that nature. And I've taken these and cut them and glued them down on a base and then taken a house or a truck or a model, sat it on it, and it's like instant diorama. I mean, I would encourage you to come up and look at these things. They're really beautiful. They're textured. They have a lot of different colors in them. Really neat stuff, but we're bringing a whole lot of different new scenery products in. I would encourage you to grab a catalog, look into the section for Scenescapes, and see what the new products are. I just brought a few here just to kind of show you that we're doing this. Okay, so that's enough of that. What I want to do now, I hope I have room here. I'm going to move all my toys here back. That's what I like about being at the Toy Train Museum. I can call these toys and not get hammered by everybody. You go to the NMRA convention, you can't say these are toy trains. In a lot of trouble. Okay, I'm going to bring something up here. And this is a pre-production prototype, so there may be a few banged up pieces on it. Almost have enough room. So close enough. Okay, now I know what you've all been asking yourself the whole time I've been up here. Jack, what the heck's with that shirt? Come on, what's the deal? I wore this because of this product. I really, really, really like this product. I'm really excited about this because it's something that encompasses a lot of things I like. Like I said, it's Jack's like day. It encompasses history. It encompasses toy trains. It encompasses Disney Pixar. And this is my Toy Story shirt. I got a whole bunch of Pixar shirts. The reason there is a connection here between my shirt and this train. How many of you guys out there, and I'm sure you're all TCA members, who knows of Ward Kimball? That's a good percentage, but now I'm going to educate the rest of you. Ward Kimball was one of Disney's 9 old men. In other words, in the 1930s and 40s, Disney had 9 main animators. And 2 of the animators were Ward Kimball and Ollie Johnston. The reason I specifically mention those two are that Ward Kimball and Ollie Johnston were railroad fanatics. I mean, they were railroad guys, what we call, you know, train heads. They loved trains, they loved railroading, and Ward Kimball had an actual railroad. He went out, and I think this is funny because my wife, you know, I read this line to her, and she just kind of stared at me and shook her head like, uh-huh. When Ward met his wife, Betty, their first date was to a rail yard to measure a boxcar. How many of you guys have done that one? I have. I have a good story. I digress, but we live close to the New Hope Railroad, which is a tourist railroad. This goes along with what I just said. And we went to Wahaska or to the New Hope or Peddler's Village, which is a shopping area right there, with my son, my daughter, their cousin, and my wife in the car, and I'm driving. And we get to the rail crossing, the grade crossing, where the New Hope steam train comes across. And as we get there, here comes the train. So Jack looks over and goes, "Oh boy!" And in the back of the car here, "Oh no!" Because they knew I was going to pull the car over and wave at the engineer and talk to him, and we did. But same deal. You know, we all love trains. Ward loved them especially strongly, to the point where he bought a coach. He went out and he bought a narrow gauge coach from the Southern Pacific Railroad in, I think, 38, somewhere around there. And his intent was to house his collection of toy trains in this train car. You know, he was going to take it home to his house, you know, and I didn't bring my paperwork out, but he was going to take it to his house, which is in California, in the orange groves, put it there and put all his toy trains in it. Well, like 6 months later, he found out that there was an 1881 steam locomotive for sale. Now, he bought the passenger car for $50. Think about that. He bought a narrow gauge passenger car for $50. Then he finds out that this locomotive's for sale. So he goes and he buys the locomotive for $400. $400 for a steam locomotive. So right there, he saved this locomotive and he brought it back to his house. So obviously, this wasn't going to house trains anymore, toy trains. It became what they called, him and his wife named it, the Grizzly Flats Railroad. And he bought other cars. He bought a stock car, a gondola, a caboose, various other things. He ended up with a little Baldwin steam engine that was in Hawaii, I believe, on a sugar plantation. There's one of those up at the museum you can look at called the Chloe. So the reason this, now we're getting into the up to the point where this connects into Disney and Pixar. What Ward did was him and his friends got together. They repainted the locomotive, they cleaned it up, they got it running, basically, and he laid 500 feet of track down in his backyard. So Ward Kimball had an actual railroad in his backyard. Think about that. I mean, that's pretty amazing. So he would have steam ups on weekends where he would bring people in, friends, Hollywood people, whatever, animators, and they would fire this thing up and run it 500 feet back and forth. So in October of 1945, I believe it was, he brought a special guest. He brought Walt Disney there. And Walt Disney had loved trains through his life. But what he did was he made Walt Disney the chief engineer that day, and he put him behind the throttle of the Emma Nevada and let him run it back and forth. And according to Ward Kimball, in his own words, that was the day that Walt Disney decided that if he built a park, it had to have a live steam train around it. So there's the connection with Walt Disney and Ward Kimball, the Emma Nevada. And if any of you are Disney people or have gone to Disney World or Disneyland, you know that they have Baldwin steam locomotives that run around the parks and they maintain them. And most of the children that we know would not experience that other than going to Disneyland and seeing these things. So we're doing a model of the Emma Nevada. I was really thrilled when they decided to bring back our 260. The 260 was in our line maybe 10, 12 years ago, the first release of it. And I was really happy because I knew that the version of this locomotive that they did originally was the same one that Ward ran, the Rogers locomotive. It's the same prototype, maybe a few slight detail differences, but this is Ward Kimball's engine. So as soon as they said, "We're thinking about doing this," I jumped up and down and said, I know which one you got to do. And I get a free trip to California to photograph it and get all the information. So I got to go to the Orange Empire Railway Museum, which when Ward was, I guess it was about 2000, Ward gave all his equipment to the Orange Empire Railway Museum for posterity, so all of us can go and look at it. And right now, I believe they're restoring this locomotive. I've seen on their Facebook page that they're tearing it down. I'm hoping that they're going to do the boiler work and get it steaming again. But if you have a chance, it's a good place to go to see this. You can see one of his passenger cars, the Chloe, and so forth. But yeah, we went out, we photographed it, top, bottom, right, left, up, down, took out our color chart cards and so forth and matched all the colors. It's an exciting piece, it really is. I have a few pictures that I'm gonna put up when I go back to the Orange Hall. And there's a nice picture of Ward in his older years, a nice picture of Walt Disney with Ward in the cab that day running the engine, which I think is really exciting. Now the Grizzly Flats Railroad, which is this photo, it's a nice postcard type photo of the engine with his station. The station came from a Disney movie. In other words, Walt got so into trains with Ward that after they filmed a movie in the 50s, he took what was a three-piece set prop of this station, the Grizzly Flat Station, he gave it to Ward and said, okay, you can put this on your railroad. So Ward built a back wall on it and fixed the roof and put a whole lot of railroadania in it and made it a museum, basically. So the connection between this and my shirt, my Pixar shirt, is this station still exists. Even though Ward's railroad is gone, the equipment went into the Orange Empire Railway Museum. This is the Justy Creek Railroad. This is John Lasseter's steam railroad, the guy that owns or is the chief creative officer of Pixar. He has taken on the mantle from Ward and the animators and still runs live steam and is a real train fanatic, loves trains. I would, you know, it's really nice to see the connection. In other words, it's gone Disney to Pixar, and that it still exists and it still runs. So I'd encourage you guys to come on over. This piece, I'd say if you're interested, and I want to bring up one other thing that I was talking to Charlie at the museum here about. Ward Kimball, and this is another connection. Ward Kimball was a real proponent of the TCA. He was a very, really strong proponent of this building that you're sitting in right now. From what Charlie told me, he had a lot to do with the architecture of the building. If you go into the historic hall, a lot of the cast iron trains and so forth came from Ward Kimball's collection. There are a lot of pieces of signed memorabilia, things of that, in the archives here. So this is your heritage. In other words, this is a gentleman that felt as strongly as you do about these trains and about toy trains in general. Personally, I think that building a garden railway like this is about as close as you can get to building a railroad. In other words, none of us will ever do what Ward did. We're not going to buy a steam loco and put it in our backyard. My wife would love that. She would just love it. I'm having a hard time with the garden railroad idea with her, let alone a real train. But you know, we've all thought about, wouldn't it be great to have a caboose in the backyard where I could go out and get away and have a cup of coffee? But if you look at garden railroading is a type of railroading where you have to go out and survey your land. In other words, you gotta go out in the backyard and find a nice big spot. You gotta level that spot out. You gotta dig trenches. You gotta put in weed barrier. You gotta put crusher fines or ballast into that track where you're putting the track down. You gotta bury that track down into it. And the whole time you're crawling around on your hands and knees, trust me. It's rough, but you have to maintain it after it's done. So anybody out here, and I know a few guys that do large scale, it is as close to building a railroad as you'll get. You know, the ballast, or I should say roadbed isn't attached to the track. You got to build the roadbed. So I would encourage you guys to come over, take a look at this thing, enjoy it. I mean, I'm going to buy one of these. I don't have a model. I don't have a garden railway right now. I don't even have a model railroad. They go up at Christmas and come down at my house. I don't have a year-long train layout. But this one I'm going to buy. It's because, number one, it's beautiful. And number two, it's got the connection with the Disney and the Pixar thing, but it also is Ward's engine, and I think that it's a real piece of history. So, come to our booth. I'd be remiss if I didn't do this, and the boss would really love it. The new catalog is out, and notice what's on the front is Grizzly Flats, the Yemen, Nevada. Come over, grab a catalog here. If there's some, there should be some left if you need one. Come to the booth in the Orange Hall. We have actually four versions of this engine coming out. We're releasing the Yemen Nevada, which is my favorite, obviously. We're gonna do a Denver and Rio Grande version. We're gonna do Eureka and Palisades, which is a beautiful locomotive. And we're gonna do the Glenbrook, which is a 260 that was just restored by the Nevada State Railway Museum. So you can go online and see pictures of that and come and see our model of it. So there'll be all four of those. And we did passenger cars to match everything. And I think, you know, I love the Grizzly Flats, but the Eureka and Palisades cars are stunning. I mean, you have to come and see these with all their cream color with all kinds of pinstriping on them and nice nameplates. Come and look at them. So come and get a catalog. Come to our website, which is www.bachmanntrains.com. That's Bachmann with two N's, bachmanntrains.com. If you need parts, there's a service area on the website. There's a YouTube channel you can click on and see all kinds of videos of our trains. Just tool around and look at the website and see what you like. And if I think that's all I've got for now. So if anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to take them right now. Do you have a question?
Yes.
Okay.
The Mm-hmm. How far is that?
Okay, the gentleman asked what the range is on our Bluetooth Easy app. The Easy app range is between 100 and 150 feet. So it's got plenty of range. It's Bluetooth 4. Bluetooth 4 is not like old Bluetooth where you had about a 10-foot range. It's 100, 150 feet. As an example, the development guys and myself went out to a baseball field and we set up a loop of track on home plate and went way out beyond center field over the wall and we were still running the trains. So it's got plenty of range.
That's a try. That's tremendous.
Mm-hmm. It's good stuff. It's simple. It's the simplicity. You got to try it. The cars are available now. We expect the engine in probably around the end of May, early June.
Is that just conventional?
It's conventional operation, but it does feature a non-proprietary interface board in the tender, which means it has an electronics board that's wired into all the functions so that if you want to put a DCC decoder in it, you can either plug it direct in with a 21-pin plug or we give you an adapter board that you can just wire the decoder into. So in other words, you don't have to open up the engine to get at the wiring. It's all right in the tender. And there's switches so that you can run track power or battery power, switch the polarity and so forth. And there's also battery terminals in the tender. So it's regular conventional running, but if you want to put a control system in, we've made it easy for you. Anybody else? Okay, that's all I got. Come see us in the Orange Hall. Thank you.